How are you, Bu?
I'm doing good.
Yeah, how are you? You're doing well. Yeah, I'm good too. What is your reaction to Sri Mulyani's statement? Do you agree or disagree, and what's your reason?
Well, actually, this is not quite surprising actually for us.
Yeah.
Actually, Rumah 123 since 2017, we have actually putting a campaign or an alert that it will be very hard for millennials to own a house actually.
Yep.
That was back in 2017.
So you agree with the statement?
Correct. So we have actually forecasted this based actually on our research and also the behavior of millennials.
Yep.
And then back in 2017, then we put this campaign. If you save of buying a coffee a day, you can actually own a house, right?
Okay, for so how long?
So there has been a campaign since 2017, so now it's been 5 years. So we do agree actually with the statement of Ibu Sri Mulyani, but I think we shouldn't stop there. I think we have been seeing actually for the last, especially after pandemic, that the government has actually make a lot of choices and has eased up in terms of the VAT, like the tax, BPNTP, you know, like then put a relaxation on the interest rate until 2021. So we have been seeing actually quite a positive trend actually from 2020 to 2021.
Okay.
That has increased actually about 32% in terms of property sales. And this number actually surpassed the 2019. But we have been seeing actually from 2021 up to 2020 right now, it's a bit flat,
Okay.
So maybe that's also due to the fact that the PPNTB actually, it has stopped actually in June, So, but I think this is very good that Ibu Sri Mulyani actually expressed this, but Rumah 123 has actually been very actively promoting and encouraging actually in terms of young people or all Indonesians, this is the time for you to buy property now.
All right.
Yeah.
And we all know that the pandemic influenced the economy greatly, the economic condition greatly. But just before the pandemic, what is actually the buying pattern for first-time home buyers?
Oh, okay. So the buying pattern actually for the first-time home buyers has always been like investors, mainly dominated by investors. However, after pandemic, because of the lifestyle, you know, we need to stay at home due to the different working patterns.
Okay.
I think this has triggered a lot of millennials especially. And maybe not only millennials, but a lot of people who don't have a house, then they realize actually they need to have a house.
Okay.
The lifestyle has changed. Maybe this is called endemic already, but there have been a lot of companies that still put like the WFH, the combination between staying at home, and then offices. So this has encouraged actually a lot of people, we need to have a house, meaning like we need to have space between the children, you know, like and the parents. So this has triggered actually people start thinking of owning a house.
So
the difference is actually now, after pandemic, a lot of the house purchase actually are the end users or the first-time home buyers, which is good. Because a lot of the new development, when I ask them, like the developers, who are actually purchasing this? Now it's the end users. However, the different pattern actually is easier for you to convince investors usually because they have the money already, they know they don't want to invest. However, with the first-time home buyers, there's been a lot of considerations, right? In terms of locations, in terms of size, in terms of the activities and so on, facilities and, you know, so many considerations. So this is where our part as portal and especially with the other property stakeholders like developers and agents. So how can we convince people to make the choice actually faster? So this is just the different patterns right now that we've been seeing after pandemic.
Yes, so for each category, the preference differs actually.
Correct.
Right. Okay, so how does Indonesia's housing market stack up if we compare with other country in Southeast Asia?
Okay. So actually, in terms of the property market in Indonesia, it's been, like I've mentioned previously, so in 2021, actually it had increased about 32%, so quite drastically. However, if we do compare, for example, like Vietnam, the increase actually in 2021 actually has jumped up even higher than Indonesia. But it showed a dip actually in 2020 compared to Indonesia. The dip in 2020 in Indonesia was only about 13%. But in Vietnam, it's actually a lot more than 13%. However, the take-up rate actually now in Indonesia, it's just a little bit flat for the first half of 2022. We're hoping that it shows better actually for the second half. But in Vietnam, it has grown actually more than 3% compared to Indonesia. So in Indonesia, I would say the price increase mm-hmm. in terms of the property,
yep.
it's overall, yeah. I mean, I cannot take this in all markets yep. or in different locations. It's actually only 1.5%. But in other markets, like for example, like Singapore, mm-hmm. the price changes actually had gone up to 9.8%. So Singapore actually, in terms of the price change of property, it has outranged all the other Southeast Asia region. In Kuala Lumpur, bit flat, mm-hmm. and in Bangkok, the growth is only like around 3.7%, 2.7%, sorry. Mm-hmm. And then, so I would say Indonesia is one of the lowest in terms of the increase of property price right now, until the beginning of 2022. But after the beginning of 2022, now we have been seeing actually in terms of the secondary prices have gone up more than actually 10%. So hopefully we are seeing actually more demand in the market, which is that's what we're seeing now. Okay. But in terms of the purchasing power and the decision, we're seeing this a bit flat right now.
So the beginning of this year has shown a sign of
Correct.
A recovering economy condition
Correct.
In Indonesia, right?
Yes.
So how does inflation, both domestically and abroad, affect Indonesia's housing market?
Yes.
Like from the US, affect Indonesia?
Yeah.
Like the Bu Sri Mulyani have said before.
Yeah. So we have been seeing actually for the property that the price of steel mm-hmm. and cement had actually increased.
Okay.
Quite significantly, more than 10%. So this, of course, this has affected the price of property itself
yeah.
because property, you cannot build property without
yes,
steel
true,
and cement, right?
True.
Those
yeah,
are
yeah,
the
yeah,
main
yeah, yeah.
Then that's indirectly because mm-hmm. of due to the inflation. Mm-hmm. However, in terms of the indirectly in terms of the mortgage, what we can see actually, the inflation has affected the mortgage. Although Bank Indonesia has not increased their mortgage rate in July, even the 7 days reverse repo rate, it actually stays stabilized in 3.5%. However, the Fed, as we know now, actually we are waiting on the announcement is actually on the 10th of this month. So that's tomorrow.
Yep.
So the Fed actually has tried to suppress the interest rate because their guidance is around 3 to 3.5%, right? So if the Fed has to increase the interest rate, this might affect also then Bank Indonesia might need to adjust on the interest
yes,
rate.
Yes, automatically.
So we'll see. So this is actually the challenge for all the property markets right now in Indonesia in terms of how can we convince the consumer that if the mortgage rate is going to increase, let's say next month or the next 2 months, then maybe that will affect the affordability of people owning a house. I guess this is what Ibu Sri Mulyani was referring to.
Okay, all right.
She so, can see the sign it already.
Yeah, okay, Bu. So now let's move on to a lighter note. Which Indonesian city is actually favored by millennials?
Indonesian city. So I guess I can only see this based on our data, yeah? Mm-hmm. In terms of property search right now,
yep.
so the demand mm-hmm. in terms of the cities, I would say it's still Jabodetabek area is
okay.
one of the high, actually
okay.
the highest.
Okay. Okay.
And then comes in second, it's actually Surabaya,
yeah.
and then Bandung,
mm-hmm.
and then after that, all the Jawa Tengah or Central Java area,
okay.
like Semarang, Solo,
mm-hmm.
and then there is the Daerah Istimewa Yogyakarta,
okay.
right?
Okay.
So
Jabodetabek
yeah.
and around Java area.
Correct.
But
correct.
I read that East Kalimantan sells more than Jakarta now.
Yes,
what is your opinion about that?
Due to the plan of moving the capital, right?
Yeah.
So I guess, we can say it's increasing because previously maybe the number was really small.
Okay.
So the increase might see
significant.
Significant, right? But again, I still believe that Jakarta will still be dominated in terms of the property search. So at one point, yes, Kalimantan, maybe it's increasing now because there has not been a lot of interest there. However, I still believe that, I mean, this happens in all countries, right?
Yes.
Like Malaysia, in all the countries, the capital city is totally different compared to really like the city, the life of the city of that country itself. So I still believe Jakarta is still being dominated.
If accumulated, Jakarta
yes.
is still wins the property competition,
correct.
Right?
Correct.
Okay, thank you so much, Ibu, for your time and your insight. It's been very beneficial for all of us.
Thank you.
And those were the economics and business updates for this hour. When we return, Carol will bring you the latest from the world of sports. So stay with us on 3RD Show.